Oh, Steve, what happened to you?
I was cruising here in my new Camry when I saw smoke coming from the pet store. So I called 911 on the Bluetooth and began the rescue. I ran in and saved all sorts of pets. The owner gave me this ferret as a reward.
Wait, you got a new Camry?
The 2017 Camry. It'll surprise a few people.
Right now, qualified buyers get 0% APR financing for 72 months on a new 2017 Camry. Toyota. Let's go places. Visit gscoffer.com for details. Offers available in select states and 5117.
Everybody, this is Bunkhouse Bob.
And the lovely Laura.
Folks, live from the Armory Wrestling Show is the flagship program of FNX.network. Make no mistake about it, we are the flagship program of FNX. But please go and check out great shows like Wrestle Radio Australia, Shoot the Defense, World's Almost Finest Podcast, but of course, listen to Live from the Armory Wrestling Show, heard only on
FNX.
See ya.
Welcome to Live from the Armory Wrestling Show, the premier podcast of indie wrestling.
We'll have to put out like a disclaimer. Stu Young says do not Google Taco Slapper.
Our studio line is area code 213-816-1605. With your host, Bunkhouse Bob.
That sounds like you don't have a lot of confidence in the Bravado Brothers against one Adam Page and Corey Hollis.
And the lovely Laura.
I don't trust that hobbit in that
City Muck Terry Awful and the Down South Dandy Nick Iggy.
We're the Carnies Team IOU, and you're listening to Live from the Armory.
Welcome to Live.
This is what happens when you put me in charge. Things like that happen. Hey, everybody. It's lovely Laura. And I am flying with George Coles tonight as our co-host, Bob. Unfortunately, is under the weather a little bit. So get well soon, Bob. Sorry I messed all that up. Anyway, welcome, everyone, to Live from the Armory this week. We're excited to have our very good friend, my very good friend, Robert Holt, on from Fisticuffs Photography. We're going to talk about some photography and all things wrestling with Mr. Holt. As always, we want to thank everyone and for listening to the show. And if you're a newcomer, certainly hope that you stay on. We've had some great interviews in the past, which you can check out at blogtalk.com/livefromthearmory. Just type in Live from the Armory in the search engine. It'll get you right to us. You can hear us on iTunes, on Stitcher Radio, and also on the FNX Network. We are the flagship station of the FNX Network. Don't forget about that. Also, we support Project Kindness. We support the Ignite Advocacy as well. And while I'm sitting here spouting off, I'm going to bring on my good friend, Mr. George International Cole. Me in charge.
Laura, George. I'm here. Can you hear me?
I can
hear
you.
I think we got it together. Laura, if you
well,
hear some jingling,
well, as much as we
jangling,
can possibly do it. Do what?
I just want to set it right off the top. If you hear some jingling and jangling over the microphone, that's Bob's boots. They're extremely hard to fill.
Oh, Lordy, don't give him a big head. I mean, for real. Oh.
Hey, we can give him crap when he's at 100%, but when he's under the weather, we gotta treat him with the respect that he deserves.
Kit gloves there. Yeah, well, and I have, except for you walking into the Darth Bob there. I couldn't resist that. You know, our good friend Luke from Australia. So if you don't know what we're talking about, check out our Twitter feed. It's pretty funny. Speaking of our Twitter feed, I'm going to give out our social media information. Mr. George Coles is running the Twitter account tonight as I am trying to run the board, which you can see I did just a bang-up job just a minute ago. You can find us, you can find George tweeting at From the Armory tonight. You can tweet along with me and my everyday life at Circle Sky. You can tweet along with George at Heel Heat. You can tweet along with Bob at Bob_Delt. Sorry about that. I just totally went blank. We're on Facebook.
Tell me you forgot
we have
Bob
an official...
already.
I know, right? He already texted me, sent me a message earlier. You know, you got everything ready for the show? And I was like, yeah, yeah. And I did. I just forgot that. I forgot that the bump has the intro in it as well, so that was my fault. So you can follow us at Facebook at facebook.com/live.armory.9. That's our official Facebook page. And we have a Fans of Live from the Armory. It is a closed group, but if you request to be let in, we will do that. We admit all respectful fans. And we also have a YouTube channel. You can find us at youtube.com. Just type in Live from the Armory. And so now that we got all that shtick out of the way, George, well, how was your week? You know, let me know, brother.
Man, I tell you what, I had a really good week. As you know, as I was talking to you, I just got a brand new TV delivered, so I'm pretty happy about that.
Awesome.
We had Royal Rumble weekend, which some ups and downs during the weekend. I thought some fantastic matches, Samoa Joe and Bobby Roode, AJ Styles and John Cena, just some really good stuff over the weekend. The Royal Rumble itself maybe been a little bit lackluster, but a lot of the surroundings were very exciting and fun. You know, and that's what it's all about, is the fun part of it. Even if we didn't
true,
like
right?
some of the results.
You know, I have massive respect for Randy Orton. I'm just curious as to where they're going with this.
I have a theory that Bray Wyatt's going to win the Elimination Chamber. And it's going to set up Wyatt and Orton for the SmackDown Championship. I forget what they call it. I believe that's the World Championship, right? And then Raw's the Universal.
Yeah, that's the WWE. That's the World Heavyweight title, you know.
I wish they would just call them the Raw Championship and the SmackDown Championship. It would be so much easier. Or the Red Championship
too.
In blue. Or the Fruit Roll-Up
exactly
in the,
right.
the Blueberry.
Yeah, that thing does look like a strawberry fruit roll-up, doesn't it?
I've always wondered, and this is no disrespect to Kevin Steen, if no matter, because he's pretty much been the only one that's held it other than Finn Balor for about 18 hours. I've always wondered why he hasn't taken a bite out of it, or at least pretended to on screen. I know
well,
I would
know. Is this thing really?
Especially when he's sitting
there.
Especially when he's sitting there with Jericho talking, I would have, you know, just something funny for the fans, because I know I'm not the only person that I've heard called a fruit roll up, and every
right,
time I
yeah.
bring it up, people go, "Yep," they go, "Yep, yeah, it's exactly right. It does look like one."
I'm just interested in seeing, where they're going to go with this. But, you know, I've, in our Live from the Armory pool, I had, I can't remember, I think I had number, and I had number 30, I know, but I can't remember what other number I had, but whatever the first number I had was Mark Henry. And then Roman Reigns comes out at 30, and I'm like, well, not that I want him to win this, but I might have a chance of winning this. But, I mean, the you know, and Triple F had posted that on Facebook and tagged a bunch of us in it, that, you know, he doesn't keep up with WWE and was, you know, wondering what all the, you know, the collective groan from the whole, I mean, I hate to be like Michael Cole, but from the whole WWE universe, when he was, you know, when he came out at 30, it was just like.
Well, I think it's a combination of a few things. I think that if you notice this Royal Rumble, other than Ty Dillinger, really no surprise entrances. I mean, we had last year, we had AJ Styles. The year before, we had DDP and Bully Ray. I mean, the Royal Rumble is known to give you a surprise, or at least they throw out somebody funny like the Boogeyman or Santino, or, you know, something fun in the middle of the match. This year, it just, and to me, the number 30, I believe a lot of people were waiting for Samoa Joe or Nakamura or Kenny Omega or, you know, any number of guys to show up in that spot. Bobby Roode, I mean. And when it was Roman Reigns, I believe it's almost like the year that Rey Mysterio came out at 30 and they held Daniel Bryan out of the Rumble. It's not that we're necessarily booing him; we're just booing that somebody else wasn't there.
Right. I was expecting Joe, but, you know, we all see
that actually ended up. I think that ended up better for him. I think his debut was a little better. Short of him winning the Royal Rumble, I don't think he would have had that big of an impact. No pun intended.
Yeah, I think you're right. Yeah. I do think you're right.
I mean, he just flew onto the screen and, in a violent manner. I don't think we've seen that show since the Kurt Angle feud.
I think you're right. I think you're right. And with that comes something we'll talk about a little later. Seth Rollins is injured again. He's injured his knee again, and there's been a lot of backlash about, you know, people saying, "Well, Joe hurt." Was it Nakamura he hurt? And
no, it was, Tyson Kidd.
Tyson Kidd, sorry. He hurt Tyson Kidd.
Yeah, Tyson Kidd, he's the one that hurt his neck, but...
Why? But,
I don't know.
You know, it does, and there's like other people on the same, you know, on the flip side of the coin are like, well, you know, Seth Rollins ended Sting's career. He hurt John Cena. He hurt Finn Balor. So, yeah, I mean, I think it's just, you know, this ain't, you know, tap dancing, people. This is wrestling. It's going to happen. So,
if you look through the history, even your greatest wrestlers, I mean, your safest guys, they've been hurt. They've been injured. I remember Great Muta versus Chono, I believe it was, where they got the Muta scale from, where he almost bled out in the middle of the ring. And those guys are as safe as you're going to be. And two of the best technicians there ever has been. And, you know, it's inevitable. People are going to get hurt. With the amount of matches that Samoa Joe has behind him, it's hard to say, you know, is it that Samoa Joe's dangerous, or is it just the law of averages? 1,000 matches and you're going to have a couple injuries.
True, very true. And speaking of injuries, I don't know not that anybody got, like, really seriously hurt, but I don't know if you guys have seen White Mike taking on New Jack for Firestar Pro Wrestling.
Oh, my God, yes, I did. That was one of the highlights of my weekend, I got to admit.
Seriously.
When you told me about that link, I believe I watched it Monday afternoon. And that White Mike has it. If there's,
he sure does.
There's anything you can say about the guy, he's got the it factor times a million. And his interaction with New Jack, oh my God, it was priceless. I thought I was laughing the whole entire match. And I felt really bad for him even going in, because I know a little bit of Jack, especially from the original ECW days. He's not a comedy wrestler by any means. And he's not how should I say, a guy that you're gonna go in without getting bruised up. He's a violent, violent man, and and his matches are violent, and when the ref pulled the machete out of his pants.
That was the funniest thing. Mike was like, oh, my God.
I could not stop laughing.
Yes. See,
especially
people. He is such an, you know, the first time I ever saw him was at a grindhouse show for Fireball. So I'm wrestling.
Yeah.
I seen him hanging out with the Ford brothers. I didn't know who the hell he was. He was at a WrestleCade one year. And he kept popping up in pictures. I'm like, who is this guy? And then, you know, Jason Ford was like, let's White Mike. And I'm like, that's who? White Mike. I'm like, well, does he feel like he needs to classify himself as white? I mean, we can all see he's white. But the funniest thing ever, and if you've never seen him do it, I don't know if there's video, but when he does the Son of Sex Ferguson gimmick, he asked Luke Gallows, hey, can I do the Son of Sex Ferguson gimmick? Luke's like, I don't care. Oh, my God, George. That is
of
the funniest
not.
Shit ever.
Well,
I mean,
well, when the guy that looks like him does the Son of Sex Ferguson, you know, gotta keep casing. That's two different guys, Laura.
I'm sorry.
Sami Zayn is Generico's trainee. He's not El Generico.
That's right. You know, Mexican
counterpart. The Midnight Rider just happened to have the same birthmark. They're not the same guy.
Yeah, I mean, where's the, you know, those things happen, people. Those things happen. Real quick, let me go through some stuff here. You know, there was an Omega, Impact, TNA, CWF show in Gibsonville this weekend. The Broken Hearties were victorious. Yes. Matt had on some kind of, it looked like an Egyptian kind of getup. It was awesome, but, you know, if y'all don't like Broken Matt Hardy, I got one word for you. We were talking, you know, you mentioned Kenny Omega. He did not appear in the Royal Rumble as rumored. So I guess he's decided to stay with New Japan.
Yeah, that's what all the leanings are. And to his credit, he came out the day before the Rumble and said, don't expect me to be there. Now, I didn't believe it because we all know wrestling's all a work, so I didn't take him at face value.
Right.
But he did do a service to the fans saying, look, do not expect me to be at the Rumble. I am not going to be there, even if I sign with him. Which I thought was pretty cool for him to do. Even if I didn't believe
it. Right. Wanted to give a shout out to James Drake. I saw him posted in the Ring of Honor training camp photo that was up in Raleigh. Was it in Raleigh? I know it was in North Carolina somewhere, right? Or is it? I can't remember exactly where it was, but
I believe it is. And if you remember, a couple weeks ago, Bob Evans was talking about that, how the Carolinas have a hotbed of talent, so it's only smart for them to want a trial camp in the Carolinas.
Exactly.
With all the talent that's there.
So
now, if they can only push
saw,
the talent properly that they pick up.
This is true. And speaking of that, just real quick, I did want to mention that last Thursday night, Caleb Conley finally debuted for Impact Wrestling. Can you believe it, people?
How?
Can you believe it?
How cool was that promo?
That was a great promo.
I don't know how anybody in the back with I don't know, I forget what the name of the new company running it is. I don't know how they don't look at that guy and see a star.
Right. Well, and you know, it's encouraging that they have taken the time to make a little package, a little introduction package. This is who this guy is. This is where he's from. And, you know, he didn't win, but he didn't get pinned either, and that's, you know, a good thing.
Yeah, I thought he looked good in the match. He proved he belonged, which is one of the main things that he needed to do.
He sure did. And I saw him at AML on Sunday, and he was just, you know, aglow when you would talk to him about being on Impact. And speaking of AML, real quick, they had a tremendous show Saturday night in Winston-Salem. Speaking of Caleb, he and Billy Brash had a wonderful match. And promoters, don't sleep on Billy Brash. He is a great heel and a hard worker. You guys need to book him. Now, of course, he knew us from PWX, but, you know, we were giving him, you know, all kinds of crap. And, you know, one time I yelled in the ring, I said, knock the taste out of his mouth, Caleb. And Billy looks at me and says, I think he just did. So he's very interactive, you know, with the fans. He's a great heel. Book this guy. Don't sleep on him. Because I have a feeling, you know, he took a little time off. He's getting back into it. I have a feeling that by the end of the year, we're all going to be talking about Billy Brash. At that show, got to meet Teddy Long, who, if you guys have not met him, what a treasure he is. And John and I, and he talked about his days as a referee in the NWA when, you know, I didn't mention this at the time, but, you know, when he didn't have any tooth. Yeah, he was so happy that somebody knew that, you know, other than his WWE stuff. So Tony Atlas scared the crap out of me because as I was reaching over to give something to Teddy, I think I was reaching over to get an autograph or something, Tony Atlas grabbed my arm, scared the crap out of me. I didn't even expect it. It wasn't even, you know, he's like, can I help you? And I'm like, yeah, you can let go of my arm. So it could be worse.
He could have been grabbing for your shoes.
That's true. I had a little slip on shoes too, so.
Oh God, you're a walking target for him.
Exactly. He's from Roanoke, Virginia, by the way, which is like 30 minutes from where I work. So I actually wanted to talk to him, but I didn't get a chance to because I was wanting to talk to him about Roanoke and what a great wrestling town Roanoke is.
Oh, yeah.
I would be do what, George?
Oh, yeah, definitely. Roanoke is historically one of the great hotbeds for wrestling all the way back to even before the Crockett days.
Oh, yeah. I mean, before they moved to the Civic Center, they would go to the Star Skating Rink, which is no longer in Roanoke, and another place, and right now the name of it escapes me. But, yeah, Roanoke definitely is a great wrestling town. I saw the Road Warriors in their prime in 87 in Roanoke, so, yeah. And, you know, Raw still comes. WWE, they sell out the place every time they come. I don't know why they don't come back more, but anyway. I'd be remiss in not saying that it was good to see Darius Lockhart as well. He is a new member of the Revolt. And I really wasn't expecting Zane Riley to be there. I brought Caleb some Sour Patch Kids, and I didn't bring any gummy bears. So, yeah, sorry, Zane. I didn't actually get to speak to him either because he was kind of working behind the scenes. Because I thought he was going to be a gouge. But I guess, you know, it's not that far from Raleigh.
Yeah, he brought full double duty.
You what?
He probably pulled double duty that night.
You
always
got
to expect Zane to be. Here's the one thing about Zane. you got to expect him where you don't expect him.
I mean, after all this time, I should, but, you know, I thought, well, you know, he's going to be at Gals. He won't be there. And I walk in the door, and there he is. I'm like, shit. Oops. Anyway. Yeah.
And so, we'll you mentioned for a second, before we go too far out, how awesome has Darius Lockhart been for the last about 6 months to a year? He's really stepped his game up.
He is on a meteoric rise. He certainly has, and he's proven that he can hang in with the big boys. I mean, just
not
incredible.
That he was bad before then.
Right.
Just that
right.
Something's clicked, and I want to say it's within the last year or so, something's clicked in him. He's hitting on all cylinders where I think he's quietly taking Cedric Alexander's position.
I think so, too, and there needs to be someone to step in and fill those huge shoes. I think his going to England is what really has helped him and gotten him to where he is now, giving him that little extra oomph, you know.
How hot is England as a territory itself? Well, not
exactly.
A territory,
I mean,
a country, but...
It's so hot that the WWE went over there and established a championship.
Yeah.
You know?
And look at all the guys on their roster. They got four or five of them in the cruiserweight division, a couple more down in NXT.
Exactly.
England,
insane. I mean...
Yeah, it's where it's at now.
Exactly. White Mike wrestled Darius Lockhart. He beat Darius, but that match was so funny. I wish you guys, and the pictures really don't do it justice, of Tommy Thomas doing some kind of dance. You know, it is, unfortunately, it can't be unseen, people. It just really can't. And that's all I'm going to say about that, because I still have, you know, unpleasant thoughts about.
Don't you talk bad about my friend Tommy. He cannot help it that he's challenged in the dancing department. He can't help that he's a Carlton of ring managers.
Oh, Lordy, I'm telling you. But that match was so good between the two of them. White Mike hits him right in the head and goes, "Try my thing." Thought I was going to die. you know, the power had this super suplex and all the members of the Mason-Dixon line. Good Lord. I'm telling you what, that's another group you don't need to sleep on, people, is the power. Seriously. Book them on your shows. And the Expendables, of course, with my friend George South, were impressive as always. And Cody Rhodes, I'm telling you. Man shows up in a suit and tie and, you know, took pictures of people in the ring. And then when he got finished with his match, he said, "I'll stay here all night if I have to sign autographs and talk to people." And he did.
Action.
I mean, he was... And he doesn't do the whole gimmick table thing. He didn't bring any shirts or anything. Because I think it's because he's not used to that, because he never did anything on the indies a whole lot, you know. And so if he would have brought those shirts, he'd have made a killing.
I got an update from the Grey Lobster. According to White Mike, the dance Tommy Thomas was doing was called the Dirty Drizzle.
That's right, I forgot the Dirty Drizzle. I'm not sure, I don't want to know what exactly
know what
the
is.
Dirty
I guess,
Drizzle is.
I guess I'm too old to know what the Dirty Drizzle is.
Well, I think Darius alluded to what the Dirty Drizzle was when he had White Mike in like this rowboat kind of thing.
It kind of sounds like the Big Wiggle, where it's something on the lines of decency.
Well, this is White Mike we're talking about.
Yeah. White Mike does straddle that line. And do a whole bunch of other things with it as well.
Oh, I'm telling you.
Boy, I tell you what. White Mike, you need to send us a check, all this that we're putting you over tonight.
Yeah, he came up to me. He came up to me and said, because, you know, Ethan Case last week said, you know, I think White Mike just butt dials you to get mentioned on the show. And White Mike came up to me and says, I really don't butt dial you just to get on the show. I'm like, I know that, Mike. It just happens. He says, I don't even know how it happens. And his phone doesn't have a lock on it. And he says, I'm just curious, what do you hear? And I'm like, I hear this. I mean, you don't hear, you can't really make out what you're hearing. You know, it's talking, but it's not like really, you know, audible. You know, it's like, you know.
I do without, the same thing. We've all done it. Mine does the most random people on my phone list. You would think it'd be the last person
me.
You called or the person on the top
right.
of the list.
But it's always me and Keith Lindsay, and Mike doesn't ever call me. It's just when he butt dials. So, you know, it's not like we have any kind of communication going on. It's just this is what happens. And I see that our guest. Say what?
And one day you're going to be surprised when he calls and wants to actually talk to you.
Well, this happened at 10 o'clock at night, and I did. I answered the phone. I was like, hey, Mike. And then it's just like, you know, I couldn't hear anything. But without further ado, I'm not going to keep him holding any more than what I have. We're going to welcome our guest, Mr. Robert Holt, to the show, and we're going to cross our fingers that I do this right.
Hey, guys, it's Rob.
Hey, Rob.
I did good.
Hey, guys. Yeah, you did perfect. I've been listening the whole time. You're killing it. Don't worry.
Well, thank you. I appreciate that. Well, you know, welcome to Live from the Armory, Robert. We're honored to have you. As you know, Bob Simmons, the weather, and joining me in his stead is my good friend and the co-executive producer of this show, Mr. George Cole.
Thanks, guys. I really appreciate you having me on.
Oh, it's our pleasure.
It is our pleasure. Certainly. We like getting all kinds of people who are involved in independent wrestling in many aspects, from taking tickets to putting up the ring to being in the ring. But your job is really critical, because not only do you take in-ring shots, you also do promo work too, right?
I have, yeah. Yeah, that was one of the things that I added to my my bucket list last year, and I've been doing them pretty steady here recently.
Well, I can see why, because, you know, if you guys haven't seen Robert's work, you need to, and we'll get to where they can find Robert's work here in a little bit. But, you know, first of all, John, myself, and Adrian Horn were talking at AML, and we all agreed that you definitely photograph with the fans in mind. You do your best not to get in the way, and heck, you even ducked a couple of times when I was shooting. God bless you. You didn't have to. And do you attribute that from being a fan first, or is that something just innate from being a photographer? And what inspired you to make the transition from wrestling fan to man behind the camera?
Very good questions. And yes, absolutely. Being that fan that saw nothing but a cameraman for 2 hours has definitely made me aware of the fact that they came in, paid the price for a ticket. They need to see the show. I try to duck in and get a shot when I can. I'm not a small guy, but I try to make myself as small as possible and make sure that I don't take up their viewing space for too long. And still, sometimes I've had people say that, you know, I was in every shot they took. So I try, but I'm not always quick enough to get out of there before they snap. But I'm glad you got some pictures. And
well, thank
in
you.
Regards
I did.
To,
and,
oh yeah.
Yeah, I mean you were fine, and I can't believe they complained.
Okay.
Like, hey, I'm here to do a job. You know, I'm like, you know.
It's all good. I don't
anyway.
Sweat it. And the transition from fan to photographer was pretty natural. I mean, I was enjoying the shows. I kind of took a break from wrestling in general for about 12 or 15 years, and I got suckered back in one time because I wanted to take my kids to a live show. I took them to a PWX at Ziggy's in Winston, and we were hooked. Yeah, that was excellent. And ever since then, you know, I've been a mainstay at PWX, and I started seeing all the other promotions that were bringing in good talent. And then I saw our local talent was just amazing, so I wanted to see them everywhere I could. And part of that is following on social media, and I saw some amazing photography from people like John Moses and Josie from Triple Threat. And even Adrian took some shots that he posted that made me want to do away with my cell phone camera and just, you know, start shooting as a fan from the crowd. And after that, it just, it kind of migrated. I had a couple promotions notice that I was putting some stuff out there personally and asked me if I had ever shot ringside. And I said I hadn't, but I'd be more than willing to. And it just kind of snowballed from there.
Definitely understand why. That is, you know, at FanFest in, you know, in Charlotte, the NWA FanFest, you were there too and taking all kinds of pictures. And at WrestleCade, and, you know, bless your heart, you took that great picture of me and John and Matt Hardy and Senior Benjamin. Just, you know, and speaking of that, good Googa Mooga. What kind of lens do you use? I never realized what it was until I took that picture of you on Saturday. Jeez, you can see life on Mars with that thing. Good Lord.
It's substantial. It's still not, you know, what I think I want down the road. It's kind of a middle of the road lens for the camera body that I've got, but it has definitely suited me well. I know a lot of guys that carry multiple lenses around so they can, kind of get different, interesting shots. This one's just a, you know, a nice middle of the road Nikon that's got a decent zoom for wrestling. Mm-hmm. I couldn't shoot, you know, a football player downfield, but you know, being 15 to 20 feet back from a ring post or something, it does killer. So, yeah, one of the best investments I made last year.
Definitely. And if you guys don't know what I'm talking about, go to my Facebook page and see the picture of him taking a picture of me. Woo! I looked at that thing. I was like, good Lord. That thing is enviable, let me tell you. I'm just
well,
kind
you
of,
had a perspective on it that I haven't seen often, so I appreciate you snapping that picture. It was pretty cool.
Yeah, it was just kind of like, I'll just take a picture of you taking a picture of me. And I didn't publish that other one that I took of you going it by ringside because, you know, I don't think
thank you. Thank you. Yeah, I like to remain behind the camera as much as possible.
Well, and that's, you know, that's the bad thing about being a photographer is that, you know, there are hardly any pictures of yourself when you're behind the camera.
Right.
You know, it's like, you know, and that's the way
absolutely.
I like it myself because, you know, I don't like being in pictures too much. But it is fun, and that was the first time I'd shot with that kind of camera. I had a camera like that before that I took to a WWE SmackDown taping in 2009, like two months before it, the shutter got stuck on me. It was an Nikon D40S.
Oh, man.
And I took some great pictures. And the problem is, I think, is that you could see me in the crowd because I was like two rows back. You can see me standing up taking pictures on TV. So,
right.
And the next year I went back to a house show. They wouldn't let me take the camera in.
Yep. I've run into that a few times.
Camera.
Yeah, exactly, exactly. Yeah, I snuck mine in under the radar to a degree to NXT when they came to Concord last year. And
I don't know
they
how
said
you did because it was like a Nazi concentration camp. They were searching
everything.
Oh,
it really
I'm
was.
Like, really? Yeah.
Yeah, it was ridiculous. But no, I talked to somebody who had some common sense in the line, who was kind of patrolling and looking over the other ticket takers. And I said, hey, man, it's not a professional camera. I've been to other events, and they say as long as the lens is under 3 inches, we're cool. And he looked at it and said, yeah, that's okay. Take it on in. And he vouched for me, which I don't know if that's legit or not. I kind of made it up on the spot, but I ran with it. So, and I got some good pictures out of it. So I'm not gonna argue by any means necessary. I'll try to get a camera in there.
Well, you know, God bless you, because. Go ahead, George. I'm sorry.
You know, it's interesting. Being the Florida participant down here, I go to a ton of NXT tapings or shows or house shows, and they're very relaxed here. As long they pretty much, if you're not videotaping, they'll let you bring in any camera. I've seen people bring in tripods and set them up, and
that's awesome.
Take pictures from that.
Yeah. Well,
awesome.
I will say the last time I saw I think it was Raw in Greensboro. Of course, I full well expected they were going to do the pat down. I didn't bring any camera in, and I saw them turn some people away at the door. But as the Coliseum was clearing out, I saw tons of cameras with huge lenses on them. So maybe they
Lovely.
Don't care as much about some of the bigger shows. But, yeah, Charlotte definitely put the lockdown on cameras for that NXT taping house show.
Could have potentially been the security.
That's
well,
possible.
No,
they bring their own.
Well, we asked them, we're like, is this, you know, Cabarrus Arena or what? No, and they're like, no, this is WWE. And you couldn't even bring in a purse over a certain size.
Yeah.
That's what really got me, because I was like, I had my little small purse, and they're like, I don't know whether you can take that in. And I'm like, what? Yeah, it might be.
Yeah,
I saw tons of people taking their purses and backpacks back.
Yeah, they have that rule here, but with the Florida shows, you go to enough of them that you already know going in. Our lines just zoom right through, because everybody knows the rules before they even walk up. Kind of like you guys AML or PWX.
Right. Well, I mean, had they announced that or something, you know, I'm sure it wouldn't have been the long lines that it created, because people thought, well, one dude had this. I mean, it was like a paparazzi lens. And I looked at him. I said, dude, you're not getting in with that. What do you mean? I mean, you're not getting in with that. They're not going to let you in with that. And then like 10 minutes later, I see him walking back to his car. I'm like, I told you.
Told you, buddy.
Just weird. I mean, it really was just incredibly weird, especially with the whole purse thing. It was like, no, you can't. And I'm like, what? As long as you look in it, what difference does it make? I mean, I'll let
right,
you look in it.
Right. Well, it's just the same arena, but with ROH, none of that. No problems whatsoever taking my
You're
camera
exactly
and bag
right.
in. Yeah, so definitely not a venue thing, I don't think.
Yeah, it's definitely a WWE thing, because I think John and Adrian both took their cameras to that Ring of Honor TV taping that was.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Yeah, they were sitting two seats down from me.
Right, right. It's a small world, the Carolina wrestling.
It really is. Yeah, tiny.
Because this person is that person, is this person. You know, if you guys want to, you know, get in on some good wrestling, move to North Carolina. Come on down. I mean, I don't live in North Carolina. I live in Virginia. Not West Virginia, Bob. Virginia.
Yeah, North Carolina's definitely got the goods. I challenge anybody to come here and see shows that are put forth from like AML and PWX, and not just leave with their jaw hanging open.
Right, and feel like you got your money's worth.
Yeah, exactly.
Well,
and I have to say, earlier you guys were talking about White Mike versus New Jack. Oh, my gosh.
Right, it's Firestar.
tickets were super cheap to that, and it's free on YouTube. The fans definitely got their money's worth. That was so good.
You can't tell. I couldn't stop smiling. I tell you what. That was a special match.
It definitely was. I had the camera in front of my face most of the time, but if I peeled it away long enough, you probably would have seen me smiling ear to ear, too.
White Mike is just this, you know, I don't know if a lot of people know this or not, but when AML and Global Force had that super show in Hickory last year, Jeff Jarrett fell in love with White Mike. He couldn't stop talking about him. You know, he's like, this guy is awesome. And, you know, just kept putting him over. But if you've not seen that match, you can go to Firestar's Facebook page and click on that link there, and it'll take you to YouTube. And it's just, you know, and speaking of New Jack, I had heard, I think maybe John had told me this, that he lives in Greensboro. So we might be seeing him a little bit more around the Carolina wrestling scene now that he lives in Carolina.
From what I've been told, he's lived here before, and he's kind of split duty between here and somewhere else. But that match versus White Mike was his first Greensboro show ever. So, you know, White Mike survived it and took part in a historic match in Greensboro.
I believe survive is the opportune word.
Yeah. No stab wounds or anything. He was in very good health afterwards.
And he looked okay at AML, too.
Yeah, that's
we've
right.
We've all seen the mass transit and the Gypsy Joe videos with New Jack. He could go south pretty quick.
Yes, indeed. Absolutely.
I've met him a few times, and he's the nicest guy there is. He'll sit there, he'll laugh with you, he'll talk, and then when he gets in the ring, some totally different guy comes out.
It's true. He was talking with the fans at AML and at Firestar, and you know, had, you know, nice words for everybody, was, you know, nice in the back room with the guys. But like you said, when he gets in the ring, there's kind of like a different light behind his eyes. It's a little chilling to see the change in his persona.
Oh, I'm sure. Like Jekyll and Hyde. Because he was looking at Damian Wayne like he'd kill him. I mean, it was like, it was scary. And if you guys, speaking of New Jack, let me suggest one thing to you. It is a live $5 wrestling from, I can't even remember what year it was. El Generico was still in the indie. But it was at WrestleCon, and Colt and Marty are doing a live $5 wrestling. And what I mean by that is they're actually watching wrestling matches and commentating over them, kind of like Mystery Science Theater 3000. New Jack up there. And he's still dating Terry Reynolds. So they get him set down, and what match comes on? Match with Goldust. I thought he was going to kill Colt Cabana, and I think Colt Cabana thought he was going to kill him too. If you have not seen that, it is a treat. It is so funny, because I didn't know that much about New Jack at the time, and I knew that he was dating Terry Reynolds. But just funny. Look into that, y'all. Seriously.
I'm going to track that down.
Like I said, I can't remember what year it is, but it's when, like I said, El Generico is still on the indies, because in that little montage, El Generico sits down and does commentary with him too, and Marty DeRosa looks at him and says, how can you be so great at wrestling and suck so bad at this? Because, you know, El Generico didn't really talk that much, you know. But not to get off the subject, I was wanting to talk about mustaches. You have a great handlebar mustache, and I think you need to look into some legal action against the vaudevillains for gimmick infringement.
Thank you. Yeah, I actually had an Instagram communication back and forth with both vaudevillains, inviting them to come to a mustache off. Yeah, and when they were in Greensboro, I was trying to get them to come out before the show and do like a little mustache off, and we could have done like some live video, but because they were hiding under the ring for when the time machine came out, you know, they couldn't meet me, but I think I would have beat them hands down. But no, the mustache is is my gimmick. You know, it was one of those things that I kind of already had it, and then people started associating it with the photos and the whole fisticuffs deal. So, and now if I shave it, you know, I might not ever shoot again. So it's probably here for life. It has a life of its own.
Exactly. It does. You know, when you do, when people grow beards and mustaches, they do sometimes take on a life of their own. And my grandfather had a mustache, and I had never seen him without one. And so I'd always made him promise me he'd never shave it off, because I wouldn't know. I'm like, I wouldn't even know you, who you were without it. But it's funny. I wish you could have done that with the vaudevillains. That would have been hilarious.
Oh, it would have been awesome. It would have been awesome. I like to chalk it up to the fact that they were just scared. They couldn't compete. But the mustache thing is one of those deals where I originally grew it as a goof. I was going to be like a circus strongman for Halloween one year. So I grew it out for a few months. And yeah, then it was like No Shave November. So I kept it for another month. And then it was the dead of winter. So eventually when I shaved it, everybody was just like awestruck. And, you know, certain people said, why'd you shave it? Certain people said, I'm so glad you shaved it. And, you know, it was just one of those things that it came back every year around that time frame. And now it's this current mustache is probably celebrating its second year. So it's been with me
nice.
For a little while. Yeah.
Very nice. That's how I think, you know, you're right. That is your gimmick. And that's how people know you, you know, the photographer with the mustache.
It is. It's one of those things that you wouldn't think would go together, but it seems to be fine. So I'm going to run with it.
Heck yeah. How do you juggle it all? I mean, you're trying to take a great shot, not miss the action as a fan, not get trampled or jumped on, or I couldn't do it. I'd just be watching, and I really don't think I could stop being a fan.
Yeah, so I don't ever stop being a fan, really. If you ever watch me, and I suggest people don't do it because the action's in the ring, but you'll see me pop just like the fans for some stuff. I know the photographer is supposed to kind of be this fly on the wall and, you know, quiet
right.
and out of the way, but you can't help it. When you see somebody, you know, get devastated in the ring, your jaw drops or you turn your head away and wince, and I can't help but do that. But the other thing is, you know, I was already at all these shows sitting in the front row taking pictures the whole time anyway. All I am now is closer. So there's potential for better shots. And then also, yeah, I could get crushed. It's happened a few times. But I came home with a huge bruise on my arm one time that I received from a baseball slide through the ring by one of the Bravado Brothers, and no harm, no foul.
I knew it was going to be a Bravado Brother. I knew it.
Yeah. It was just one of those things. We were at the Hickory Stadium, and I was doing one of my first ringside gigs for a promotion from up north, and I got clipped in the arm. That same day, I almost got creamed by Cedric going over the top rope. But I got home, and my wife saw the bruise, and she's like, oh, my God, that's horrible. And she paused and just looked at me and said, I bet you love it, don't you? And I said, yeah, absolutely. It was worth every second of it.
Those are badges of honor right there.
Yeah, exactly. But no, it's hard. I miss shots all the time. It's one of those things where you just kind of have to understand it's live. Anything could happen. In wrestling, some things happen so quickly, you're not going to catch it all. And,
yeah.
I still regret some of the missed moments, but I just have to, you know, try again next time and try to freeze time and stop that move in the right place the next time I'm ringside. So that's kind of my goal, is to just continually get a little bit better, and eventually I'll have a nice body of work that kind of represents what I'm trying to do.
Well, before I turn it over to George, two things. I think you have a nice body of work already. The photo you took of Matt Hardy that's in the promo pic that we used to promote your appearance on the show, phenomenal.
Thank you.
That
that's one of my favorites of all time.
It would have to be. I mean, that was just like capturing. I mean, that's broken Matt Hardy right there. And the photo of Bob Evans that you took, that headshot.
Oh, yeah.
That is just absolutely awesome. I mean, Bob is like one of my favorite people. And I didn't go to that show in Mount Airy. I live about an hour and a half from Mount Airy, but I didn't go that night. And it seemed like it was a pretty good show with him being down there.
It really
there and everything.
Was, yeah.
And some of their shows can be kind of sketchy at times.
well,
they had
you know,
a.
What would independent wrestling be without a certain level of sketch to it?
This is true. they had a first blood match in the dark.
Ooh.
Yeah, that was interesting. And then they
now how do you know? Is it just when something gets wet, or?
I don't know. It was darker. I mean, they had a couple lights on, and I'm like, how the hell do you have a first blood match? And the lights are off. What? And then they put
that's
in
amazing.
The building.
Water in there.
Yeah, exactly.
Right.
Match
I mean,
over. I'm the winner.
And then they put us in that building when it was raining and it leaked. I was sitting
okay.
there trying
well,
to
Well, I'm familiar with that. Yeah,
okay.
I felt for the wrestlers because the building had sprung a leak, and now torrential rain for like 2 or 3 days, so I can kind of understand this old building not being able to hold up. It wasn't the location they wanted to run at, but yeah, the ramp
right.
that the guys were coming down was wet, the concrete was wet, there were actual spots on the mat where it was wet too, so yeah, I felt bad for them, because the first thing that night was over-the-top rope elimination onto wet concrete.
Oh, no.
So, you can only imagine the bodies as they hit the floor.
Yeah, sound like a thud.
Yeah. Oh, yes, yeah, yeah. That was one night where I definitely had to wince quite a bit.
Cute. And, George, I'm sorry that I cut you off in the beginning when I was introducing you. I'm very, very sorry, but I'm going to let you have the floor. It is yours.
It's no problem. We're all friends here, so. Makes everything good. Before I get into mine, we have a question from our good friend, the Gray Lobster. He wants to know
okay.
how difficult is it. He wants to know how difficult is it to take a photo of something that makes you want to turn away. So I'm guessing maybe you mean like a hardcore style match or someone that's bleeding buckets or something just that you cringe at normally.
Yeah. So, I have shot a few hardcore matches that got really, really bloody. And I think if you look at some of the pictures from that Mount Airy show, if you've got the stomach for it, you can get to there were two Falls Count Anywhere hardcore matches. Scrapyard Dogs was probably the bloodiest by far. And there's literally – oh, yeah, he's just – when he gets busted open, it just – pours, and he's got one shot where he's leaning into the ropes where he's just coated in blood, and I actually had to tone it down a little bit. I thought I was legitimately thinking that Facebook was going to pull the image or lock the account just because
yeah.
it was so gory, so I had to kind of cut it back a little bit, but that's a great question. I think the most dramatic shots, the ones that move you the most, are going to push you to extremes. So revulsion is definitely extreme. If you can't stomach the image, it made you feel something. It wasn't boring. It wasn't bland. It still evoked an emotion out of you. And I tend to not go that dark most of the time, but being a wrestling photographer, you got to kind of roll with punches and shoot whatever you're paid to shoot. And I just had to get back afterwards and wipe my camera down because it had blood on it and my flash had little speckles all over it. So, my wife made sure I had all my shots afterwards, so we're good.
There you go. That's all that matters.
Yeah, yeah, exactly.
So, going from that, looking at your work since Laura first told me to check you out, you have a style that's very unique to you. How long did it take to adopt that signature style to the art that you put out there?
Gotcha. Yeah. I don't see it as being a signature style as much as kind of an evolution of style. And it sounds weird, but I've always liked very gritty, contrast-heavy pictures. I grew up from, you know, using film and doing a lot of black and white work that was very contrasty. A lot of shots in dark clubs, shooting punk bands and metal bands and stuff like that when I was a kid. And I always really gravitated to that. When I got in the dark room, I processed it and kind of made it look even a little grungier. And then when I started applying that to wrestling, it just kind of comes through. I'm not as good at color, representing like legitimate colors, as some of the other photographers in the market. I think my black and white stuff can rival anybody, but I'm working on that color. So a lot of what you're seeing is probably what I do to maybe cover up bad lighting at some of these venues and stuff like that. But I try to make sure it's fairly consistent.
Yes.
Yeah, you know how that is.
I
appreciate that. I think all photographers eventually kind of have their go-to style. And with wrestling, I think in the last 3 or 4 months especially, I've hit like a stride. And I even felt like at the AML show last weekend, I might have even leveled up a little bit. I got some shots that I didn't think I would have been able to get. And I worked that entire ring, the back of the room. I did fan interaction shots. I did the line coming up to the building. So I really kind of pushed myself to cover as much as I possibly could.
You know, it's really funny you mentioned coming from shooting punk shows, because to me, that's what I think when I look at your shows. Like, I see a Henry Rollins jumping off the stage, or, you know, a old Rancid shot, or Operation Ivy from back in the day. And it's kind of, that's the kind of style I think in my head.
You might have just become my best friend. I mean, that's like the biggest compliment you could have given me. But no, that's really, like, at the end of the day, I've had a couple people ask me, like, what kind of wrestling photography I do or what my style is. And I normally say it's punk rock photography. It's just kind of gritty and dirty. But, you know, like I said, that's the biggest pop I'm going to have all night. I appreciate that.
Hey, it's no problem. I mean, I come from a similar thing. I like the same kind of music. So seeing all those, and I know it probably is what also influenced you, seeing all those old fanzines that you would get at the shows or get passed on from your friends, cousins, brothers, roommate, because punk really isn't a thing that you could go to the newsstand and buy a magazine about. You have to get a magazine that somebody made in their basement, and you would get those shots that were right up there in your face and gritty, and like you said, and that's kind of the same vibe I get when I see your pictures, which was kind of what I was leaning towards in there without knowing you as well as Laura did. I didn't want to just come out and say, oh, it's a punk style, but yeah, it's very cool that you said that, because that's the imagery I have in my mind when I see it.
That's awesome.
Especially,
man, I appreciate that.
From when I started, must have been mid to late 80s when I started listening to punk music, and especially that era, that explosion before, you know, everything punk went big, and Nirvana and Offspring and Green Day were all over the place, when it was still raw and organic, when it wasn't a pop punk yet.
Yeah, no, I 100% agree. I'm from that same era myself. So about like 84, 85, somewhere around there, I started getting those tapes, you know, you'd pass tapes at school and everything else. And up until that point, I was listening to, you know, metal, Sabbath and Dio and stuff like that. And somebody slid me a tape with the Violent Femmes on one side, and I think Black Flag on the back side. And at that point, I was, you know, ravenous for it. Not like all kinds of music, but, you know, that really kind of drew me in, because anybody could do it. You know, anybody could pick up an instrument and play it. It had a very much do-it-yourself attitude. And that's kind of the mentality I've had all my life, is, you know, just do it yourself. If you want it, go do it. You know, put the energy into it, make it something nice, but, you know, don't depend on anybody else for it. And that scene really was a driving force. And like you said, it kind of broke down in the early 90s with all the pop punk stuff, but My thought is there's always something out there. There's always some young, angry person putting out some music that's really good. You just got to look for it.
Definitely, definitely. We got to, one of these days, we got to slip, somehow we got to slip Laura a CD that's of some Black Flag with a Monkeys label on it so she'll actually listen to it.
Yes, yes. I think I might be able to do something about that. We'll talk after this call, George.
I might send her a copy of the Live from 84 CD, which I think is my favorite Black Flag thing ever. I just love
that.
I love
awesome
that lineup
album.
And I love that. Yeah, that's my favorite of anything they've ever done, personally. I mean, they play a little fast, but it is what it is, and they didn't fix it up for the CD, or the cassette at that time. I have it on CD.
Yeah, exactly.
Decades later.
Well, I mean,
but...
right, but that's what you get if you go to a Black Flag show at that era. I mean,
yep.
That was a representation of it, you know, bad sound quality and all.
which is,
you can say shitty. That's
that
fine.
Was my favorite era.
Yeah.
We don't have a filter.
Oh, okay, good.
But getting back on track, Laura's probably bored out of her mind going, oh, God.
I'm not. I love all kinds of music, and a lot of people who are punk rockers were inspired by the Monkees. So, hey, it's all good.
Oh, yeah. Laura, I watched the Monkees when I was a kid, like, every day to the point that my mom got tired of it. And my mother-in-law was actually at the Monkees show in Greensboro that Hendrix opened for them.
Oh,
so that's like,
yes,
her claim to fame.
Yes. Yes.
Super
oh,
fan.
Been alive back then.
See.
Right.
See, what you might not know, this is about the fifth or sixth time I've guest co-hosted here in the another time we had Johnny Yuma on from Championship Wrestling from Hollywood and other things.
That's
out
right,
on the West Coast.
Yeah.
It evolved into a punk concert and punk rock talk, and I believe Laura just sat back quietly on that one as well. But
she plays to her strengths.
That's right.
We'll get her in there
right.
Someday.
That's right.
But, bringing the train back on track, because I know Laura loves when I take it off. I have to know, is it difficult to get wrestlers and promoters to trust you and your vision for their product?
You know, I haven't had that problem yet. What's trickier with promoters is getting them to pay you what you are asking. And that's standard
right.
for, I think, the entire business. So it really should be no different for photographers. But it's one of those things that you have to show value. And that's why I put so much work into putting myself out there for several months before I even entertained the idea. I think when they see what I do online, they kind of already know what my vision is. Now, there have been some conversations about stay off of hard cam, and then I push back a little bit and say, but if a shot is happening on hard cam, I'm going to go get it. You're paying me to be the photographer. And they have to tell me whether or not that's okay. If I get pushed back at that point, it's their show. I'll sit in one corner if they want me to, but I prefer to move everywhere, go where the action is, and shoot everything. And I haven't had anybody who really fought me too hard on that once I kind of painted that picture.
Right. Well, and you got to look at it like this. The wrestlers are playing to the hard cam, so you want them to play to your camera too.
That's right. That's right. In the indies, a lot of times. Yeah, exactly. In the indies, a lot of times there's not a hard cam. You know, you might have a couple people with their cell phones recording the show at some small, promotions. So you kind of get used to working the entire room as a wrestler. Wherever there's people sitting in seats, you work everywhere. But on those bigger shows where they have a hard cam, those young guys and some of the seasoned guys, they need to work that hard cam. They've got to do it that direction. And if all the action's facing there, that's where I'm going to be too, somehow, some way.
Got to go where the action is, definitely, especially in your line of work.
Yeah,
now,
exactly. I've talked to some photographers who would prefer it to be the other way. They'd let the if the workers really want that spot, they better do it in front of me. And I think that's just asking a little bit too much with everything else that's going on. Their job's to entertain the crowd and tell the story. My job's to get the pictures. So I go wherever they're at.
See, and wow, to me, that just doesn't sound like it's organic. That sounds like you're putting a robot, 1, 2, 3, step this way, 1, 2, 3, step that way. Whereas
right,
if you're just wrestling the match, doing it by feel, and you're playing to this side of the crowd, that side of the crowd, I feel it's a much better match, much better shots, much better crowd experience. So
exactly.
I think that's silly. You got it. The main shows are wrestlers. Now, I know, I understand you have your own art, and it's a very cool art, but you know you're there to shoot them. They're not there to please you.
Correct.
Although, I'm sure they do, as a fan.
Oh, yes. Yeah, exactly. There's tons of times where, as I'm taking the picture, you know, I'm just kind of smirking to myself at the spot they pulled, or, you know, they'll mean mug me as the cameraman, or they'll ask the ref to review my pictures because they know that foot was on the rope, and they're going to prove it to that ref or something like that. So when they involve me in the show, like on the inside, I'm, you know, fanboying out. I'm like, oh, this is awesome. But since I'm now involved in the show, I try to pretend like, you know, oh, here you go, ref, here it is. You do what you got to do. But it is interesting to still have that kind of fan mentality while you're working. And I think one of the things that amazed me at WrestleCade was I really didn't stop and get fan pictures with all the wrrestlers that I wanted to, you know, talk to. I just worked the whole weekend. And if I lucked into somebody who was just standing close, I think really Pentagon Jr. is the only person that I kind of made sure I got a picture with. The year before, as a fan, man, I went through there and tried to get as many pictures as I could with people. So the work does make you focus on it, and you turn off the fanboy a little bit, but there's just some times where it kind of creeps back out. And like I said, when they do something directly into the cam just to showcase the picture, it always makes me smile.
There you go. Now, looking through your stuff, some of my favorites that you shot, some of, as far as wrestlers, are Ricochet, Matt Hardy, Billy Brush, Darius Lockhart, a bunch of others, to be honest with you. I really enjoyed those guys. So do you have anyone that you consider your favorite to take pictures of?
Man, I'm kind of like you. I like shooting a wide variety of people, and the people that you mentioned, they emote really well in the ring. They make really good facial expressions. They sell towards the camera. So it's easy to get good shots of them a lot of times. I think if I had to pick one person that personally I think I've got the best shots of over time, it's probably Rob Killjoy. When I first started shooting ringside, Rob Killjoy's got like that amazing work ethic where if it's a Tuesday night at a fair and they're paying him $5, he'll wrestle, but he'll also wrestle some huge shows and get, you know, paid what he should be. But he always wants to work. And when I was hungry and working as much as I could ringside to kind of make a name, I worked a lot of shows with him. And just looking back at like everything I've shot over the last year, I think some of the shots of him doing his chest stomp, I think some of the stuff like his moonsaults to the outside, that stuff's just so amazing. And he's so fluid that I've just caught like a ton of amazing images of him. But like you said, Darius, one of my favorites is White Mike. Timmy Lee Retton is always fantastic to shoot. I think Caleb, you guys talked about his Impact debut a little earlier, but I think Caleb Connolly always puts on a good show, and it's hard not to get a good picture because he's just putting so much out there in the ring.
Definitely. And they're all, like you said, it's different guys doing different things, but all have their own special thing. My favorite
Out
of all of them You have one, there's one of them, it's Ricochet, and I don't think he's flipping, but he's up in the air, and his body's contorted in a way that only, like, Stretch Armstrong toys could contort other than him. I was like, wow, it just shows you how amazing of athletes some of these guys really are.
Yeah,
absolutely.
Most
of them actually are.
Yeah, a lot of people have commented on those Ricochet shots, and it's primarily for that reason. It looks like such an unnatural body position, and you know, I mean, I know the one you're talking about. It's probably the black and white one where he's like sailing fist first towards his opponent, something like that.
Yeah, it looks like he's either doing a Superman punch or a flying forearm.
Yeah, he was like 9 feet in the air at that time too. He was ridiculously high sailing. And the hang time, I mean, it felt like I took 5 or 6 breaths while he was still up in the air. But, you know, that's the thing. If you've got somebody in the ring who's doing something, if they're making a face or giving an expression or cutting a promo and there's energy to it, and they're making eye contact with the fans or the camera, or they're really, you know, they're doing their job. They're doing what they're supposed to do in the ring. You'll get good pictures. And I think as fans, Laura, you can probably attest to this too. You get some amazing pictures of these guys, and you don't consider yourself a professional photographer, but you get pictures where they're doing a move or they're making an expression that really helps sell that picture. And that's a credit to them. Most of what I do is just know my hardware and know composition, know how to stop
the
action
key
a little bit. But those guys are really doing all the work. It's like an actor in front of a camera with a good director of photography. The person behind the scenes is making sure that compositionally it's right and the light's good, but the person in front of it's doing the large majority of the work.
Definitely. And this one is someone I was on a show with, Bob and Laura. I'd asked him a similar question. If you could jump in a time machine, a photographer, and photograph any match in history, what match would it be and why?
Oh my gosh, that is a great one.
I asked Laura if she had 5 matches, so. If you have more than one, it's okay.
Okay, good. That gives me an out, because two came to mind immediately. One is not even really a match. It was a weightlifting competition, a bench press competition between the Road Warriors and Ivan and Nikita Koloff, I think, at the Greensboro Coliseum. And I was up in the nosebleeds. And essentially, you know, the whole gimmick is, you know, as I think it was Animal was bench pressing, Nikita kicks one of the legs of the weight bench over, so it all collapses on his chest. The ambulance comes in, has to take him out. And just from my perspective at that time in the Greensboro Coliseum with, you know, just all the seats full and all this action and the ambulance coming in, it's one of my biggest memories. I would love to have been on the floor for that and just kind of getting fan reaction shots, the action at the weight bench, and then the ambulance coming in. I think that would have been killer. And then the other one go ahead.
Is that the match that that after that he started wearing the hockey mask because his face got shattered? Or was that a different time with the Russians?
Oh, that's a good question.
That is a good question. I don't know if it was right after that or not.
It's all in the same era, but I seem to think that because they showed it on TV, the weightlifting competition, and who knows if they did it in every arena they went to, but it definitely was
right
on the Crockett TV show because I was nowhere near the Carolinas.
The televised version came from Greensboro. I remember that.
Correct.
It came from Greensboro because you can tell the Greensboro Coliseum has a certain look about it, and you could tell it was from Greensboro. So, but you could be right. They could have done it in every arena they went to, but it was definitely
That's true.
Televised.
And, you know, he could have wore that mask after that, but the fog of time has affected my brain, and I could not tell you 100% without going back and watching.
Yeah, because they did something to his eye, because I've got a Pro Wrestling Illustrated that says, you know, Ivan Koloff, it was the Barbarian. It was when they were with Paul Jones's army.
It wasn't Nikita.
Nikita had already joined with Dusty by that time, so it was.
That's right. Yeah.
It was like the Barbarian, and Animal's like, "I'm gonna kill him for what they did to my eye." And I mean, it's a pretty. I mean, if it's makeup or whatever, it's a pretty good job for back then. But it's a cut. But yeah, I think you're right, George. I think he did start wearing that hockey mask about that time.
Yeah, I just always liked it because I was a hockey player, and it was so cool to have the Road Warrior paint on a hockey mask.
Oh, yeah,
exactly.
Yeah, absolutely.
But I digress.
Well,
I'll let you go on to your second one.
Oh, that's okay. That's okay. No, the only other one that that I think I would like to go back and shoot, and it's not a particular match, but any of the heyday of the Four Horsemen, you know, that was always like my stable as a kid. I always related more to the heel, obviously with the mustache, than I did the pretty boy faces. I always wanted them to get messed up, and I wanted the horsemen to go off in a jet with their ladies and, you know, bottles of champagne and everything else.
I know,
just a heel for life. But again, it's not any match, anything in particular, but I'd love to be like the photographer that followed them around. So a lot of those static shots you'd get in magazines or some of the stuff they would cut to when they were doing, like, interviews or recaps or stuff like that, I would have loved to have just kind of been the traveling photographer at that time who got to work with the Four Horsemen all the time. I think that would be killer.
All right, so we'll have to pin it down, though. Which Four Horsemen group?
Yeah.
There's so many incarnations that I really like, but it's definitely Rick, Tully, Ole, and Arn for me. That's the one, that I would, you know, really want to be around, but I was okay with Wyndham too.
See, I go back and forth. The Wyndham incarnation and the originals are my two favorite of them.
Same.
And I usually lean towards Wyndham because I loved Wyndham as a kid. Something about him just stood out. And I think it was because he was tall and lanky, and no one but him and Kendall were that way.
Yeah, he definitely had a different look than the roster, and I just liked the intensity that he brought to all his matches.
Oh, yeah. He's definitely one of my favorites of all time. I still love watching his matches now, even as dated as they are 30 years on down the road.
I'm the same way. I go back and watch, you know, old stuff probably more than I do current WWE product.
Yeah,
because that's good.
That says a lot about it.
Yeah. That is correct.
Barry's work in Florida, I think you can catch some of that on the High Spots Network before Florida was bought by Crockett. It's pretty good. His stuff there against Lex Luger, that's pretty good. Jesse Barr, when he was the Dirty Yellow Dog, when Barry Windham was the Dirty Yellow Dog, not Jesse Barr. But some great stuff. And also, you know, I won't tell my age a little bit, but Barry first came onto the scene as Blackjack Mulligan Jr. So he kind of had to step out of Blackjack's shadow and, you know, dyed his hair blonde and took the name, his, you know, real name, Wyndham. Barry was good. I mean, and his stuff in Crockett and... You really just can't beat that. You really, really. I didn't like it when he joined the Horsemen because I was not a heel girl.
Oh, you know? That was so great.
You rub Ricky Morton's face on the floor. I hate you. You can't be doing that.
There's something about Barry Windham coming out with J.J. Dillon that just fits so perfectly.
It made me
sick. It did. I was a fan of the Rock and Roll Express. Very happy to hear about the Hall of Fame induction and all that. But I took great joy in watching them get destroyed by the Horsemen. I might have tried to rock that hairstyle back when I was a kid, but don't let the smooth taste fool you. I was definitely down with the Horsemen instead of the Express.
Just a heel. I've got one more question for you, Robert, and I'd be remiss in not asking you this since it was my honey bunny who asked it on Twitter. John was wanting to know, what is your favorite non-wrestling event that you photographed?
Oh, wow. So as you know, Laura, most of my year was photography of wrestling. There wasn't a lot of other time for anything else. But
right.
I did go to Denver, Colorado last year for the Riot Fest. Concert, 3 days. I wasn't able to take my big camera, but I had a very small, kind of inconspicuous Fuji camera that I took in with me. And I didn't take a ton of shots, but the ones I got, I was really happy with. I got some of Jane's Addiction and some of Ween, the Meat Puppets, and Against Me, a lot of these bands that, you know, I really have always liked, and I wasn't going to be able to see them in a small club here in North Carolina.
Right.
That was a great opportunity to shoot a lot of different bands all in one time. So that's probably my favorite event outside of wrestling from last year. But I really love doing all kinds of stuff. I'm such a nerd in general that, we had Free Comic Book Day. They do it every year, but in Greensboro, we've got a great comic book store called Acme Comics, and I reached out to them to see if I could shoot it for them, and I got to see all the guys and girls dressed up and all the kids happy to get their free comic books, and that was like 12 hours that went by super fast, and I got some shots that I was really pleased with. Aside from that, sometimes just going out with my wife and kids, we'll go and hang out in the graveyard and take some spooky pictures. So just depends on what the mood is. But like I said, the biggest event outside of wrestling, definitely Riot Fest last year.
I remember those pictures, seeing those on Facebook. Those were some good shots.
It was fun. It was great to go and not have to worry about taking pictures as your job. It was just kind of like, oh, this is really neat. I'm going to take a picture of that. And the ones that I got, I was pretty satisfied with. I think we got some good ones.
And you mentioned Comic Book Day last year. So what, George?
Now I'm a little jealous because I haven't seen Against Me since before she became Laura. I've been dying to see them since then. They're such a good group, both ways, before and after. But I've been dying to see them, so now I'm a little bit jealous of you.
Well, I know they're back on tour. I think they are coming back through North Carolina in a couple of months, so hopefully they'll have a Florida date. But, yeah, they killed it. They were working one of the side stages at 2:30 in the afternoon or something like that, but it was still amazing. That new album is so good. They played a good mix of, some of the classic stuff as well as probably – about half of the new album, so I was really satisfied with their set.
You mentioned Comic Book Day, and last year I was really pissed. I missed Comic Book Day because I was recovering from surgery. That's one of my favorite days of the whole year. It's Free Comic Book Day. I think it was an AML show or a PWX show. I can't remember. You had that Motel Hell shirt on.
Oh, yeah. That was PWX.
Because I was like, oh, my God. I haven't seen that movie in forever. But that was like one of those movies that I saw as a kid, and it just left this lasting impression on me. And if you guys don't know what we're talking about, Google Motel Hell. it is. I don't mean to get off subject a little bit, but let me ask you this. I talked with you about this at PWX, and then we'll wrap up the show. But how we used to watch, you like old B movies too, right?
Absolutely.
Who doesn't?
Well, and that's why, you know, I like Matt Hardy so much, because it's like wrestling and B movies together.
That's it. That's exactly it.
Exactly. And if you don't like B movies, you're not going to like what Matt Hardy is doing. But I used
right,
to watch.
Right. Some people don't get it.
They don't, and they're just like, I don't get that. I'm like, you never will. You never will. I used to watch old B movies on this program on the USA Network that would come on Saturday afternoons. It was called Commander USA's Groovy Movie.
Yes. I remember
okay,
it vividly.
Okay. Because that was the best thing. They would have, like, old Godzilla movies, and he would have luchadors, these Mexican vampire movies with luchadors in their masks.
Oh, the old,
you know,
the
fighting
old
vampires.
El Santo,
yes,
yeah.
Yes. So
those are
yeah,
bad.
That was so good.
Those are the best. And Commander USA and Lefty, I was a member of his fan club. I still have the card here somewhere. And
That's awesome.
I know John is laughing at me because he's like, sure, you still have that card. But, yeah, so finally somebody remembers Commander USA, because they're for a while thinking, did I dream that up? Because nobody seems to remember Commander USA.
Oh, no, no. And here's the thing. If you look up Commander USA on YouTube, there are some clips out there because I found that, and I found the one that was the late night show Up All Night. And you can watch some of the old episodes and stuff like that.
See, I remember Up All Night with Rhonda. Probably.
Yes, exactly. Oh, Rhonda is very, very memorable. This is true.
Of course.
And, I don't remember the other one, but it's our local stations. See, I didn't have to change the channel. They would play the WWE show, and then they would play the Crockett show, and then from there they would go into a kung fu movie, and then after the kung fu movie it was a classic horror movie, like a Universal Monster movie, and then a B movie, and then by that time it was time for the news. So that would be what we had. So I didn't have to change the channel to go to USA, so I probably never even knew what they were watching, because I just stayed on, I think it was Fox 29 or it was either Fox 29 or Channel 17. I don't remember which one exactly, but I stayed the same channel all day, and it was awesomeness all the way through.
It sounds like it. I'm totally down with the lineup you just described, and then I would turn it off at the
yeah,
news.
That's like a perfect Saturday afternoon.
Absolutely.
Yeah,
that's all my favorite things.
Because the karate movie would kind of tie into the wrestling, and then the Universal Monster movie would kind of tie into what the karate movie was doing, and then the B movie, of course, would just be a blatant ripoff of the Universal Monster movie at some point.
Right. Yeah, that's awesome. I have fond memories of that same kind of thing, because I think everybody had that local channel, like that one channel that had their own kind of horror movie host. Ours was also the guy who did the early morning cartoon show as a different character, and he did Saturday like Kung Fu Theater as a different character. It was this one guy, and he played probably 12 different roles at the station. Hell, he's probably a station manager too. But you know, it was one of those things, like, now he's got Spock ears on. It's going to be a sci-fi movie. Okay, cool. And I just remember, you know, tuning in like that when TV still had a knob that you had to turn. So I'd dial it into the UHF channels, and I'd sit there and watch these guys act really horribly, and then put a movie on where people were acting even worse. And I loved it all.
Well,
and then if your antenna broke, you had to stick a metal hanger into the end of it.
Oh yeah,
it's
or if you were young
pole.
Enough, you were the person that held the antenna the whole time, so the rest of the
exactly.
family could watch
low,
the show.
Low man on the totem pole.
We're definitely telling our age.
See, our
yes,
generation,
we certainly are.
We
now,
didn't have remotes because we were the remotes.
Exactly.
Yeah, go change the channel. Okay, go change the channel, youngin. Yeah, okay. you grew up in Carolina, right?
Yeah, I was born in Greensboro and then moved away for a while and ended up coming back just before, junior high school. So I've been here the rest of the time pretty solid.
Okay. Well, I don't know if you remember this or not, but there was always the Shock Theater that would come on. I think it would come on, WDHP.
Yeah.
Okay, you remember that? Okay,
yeah,
good.
Absolutely.
I'm glad I didn't. It was just, I couldn't watch it because the whole opening was just like really scary.
It was.
And
it was great. I wish I had a copy of it.
Yeah, I mean, it was just like Shock Theater, and I'm like, oh no, I can't see that.
Yeah.
You know,
I can remember being pretty scared of it when I was little, but then you know you get a little older and bolder, and you're trying to act like
right.
a big kid. You're still scared, but you're sitting there and watching it shaking silently. But yeah, I definitely remember that. And we used to get, when cable first hit the area, there was a channel out of Washington, D.C. It was WDC 20. And they had their own Saturday night horror show and a host. And that was another one that just, like, it rolled through horror movie, sci-fi movie, and then it was Monty Python and then Benny Hill. So if you stayed up late enough that
like
night.
The perfect night ever. I mean.
Yeah, exactly. Oh, man. I can remember staying up past bedtime, you know, with the volume turned down as low as it could be, just so I could watch Monty Python and Benny Hill. And then I think when that went
Benny
off,
Hill.
It was Twilight Zone. And yeah, and then I'd get scared again and I'd go to bed.
You're right.
Either that or you stay up to you see the. You stay up till you see
the
Indian
pattern.
Head with the color bars.
Yeah,
the test pattern. You hear that tone?
Yep. That's when you knew, and that usually was one of those nights that you had no idea how late it was. You thought it was about midnight, but really it's 3:30 in the morning.
Exactly.
Right.
Oh yeah, way too many times. I still have those nights now, but it's infomercials that are my clue that I've stayed up too late.
I go by the actual commercials because the. If you stay awake long enough, the commercials get older and geared toward older and older people, like the or the sex line commercials start coming on.
Yes,
that's when I know it's way late at night.
Yeah,
I
that's
mean,
your clue.
I'm butt to bed.
Clock out here, people.
Yeah, it's either you either get the sex line commercials or I watch a lot of History Channel and channels like that, so you'll get the osteoporosis commercials and. Not the good ones with Jay Lethal in them either.
Right. You know, you get the ones that are, you know, it's meant for that person that went to sleep at like 4 p.m. the day before and they're
yep.
waking up at 4 a.m. Like, okay, time for your meds.
They're starting their day, yep.
Robert, it has been an absolute joy to have you on the show. It truly
hey, this,
is.
This was a blast.
We will have to do this again.
Oh, yeah, yeah. You guys let me know, and I'll come running. I thoroughly enjoyed it.
Well,
and tell
so
Bob that
to...
I want him to heal up so next time I get to talk to all three of you. That's my demand. I want George back, too.
Awesome.
Right, we can do
I
that.
Can, I can do that.
We...
Okay.
As soon as, you know, Bob, you know, Darth Bunkhouse gets, you know, his breathing mask off. If you haven't seen that picture we were talking about earlier, he has like the breathing treatment he's taking because he's got bronchitis. And yeah, and you know, we have a Australian fan, friend of the show, Luke, and I was like, and George said, you know, it looks like you look like Darth Vader, and I was like, Luke, I am your father. I couldn't resist that. Anyway,
hopefully it made him chuckle at least in his. Not too much because
yeah,
he
so.
Lose all of his breath.
Robert, tell us about some upcoming shows that you're going to be doing, if you can.
I've got a few listed here. So Friday night, I'll be in Chapel Hill at the Cat's Cradle seeing G-Love and Special Sauce, and I'll be taking pictures of that. Then Saturday,
nice.
February 11th, I'll be in Wilmington for the Modern Vintage show. I'll be shooting ringside there. The following day, I'll be back in Greensboro shooting for Firestar. And then over the next week, there's like four more dates. I think Warzone Wrestling in Fayetteville, the 17th, Queens of Combat Double Shot on the 18th, PWX on the 19th, and back to AML on the 25th. So it's going to be a busy month.
Wow. I would say so. That trek from, you know, Wilmington to Greensboro, that's, yeah.
Yeah, yeah, that one, I did it in October, and I was working a part-time job at a haunted house as well, so I left that at 3 o'clock in the morning, went home, slept for a couple hours, drove to Wilmington, shot the show, drove back at about 2 o'clock that morning. I think I ran on, like, maybe 7 hours of sleep for a total of 4 days that weekend.
Yeah. God bless you.
It's a good thing I don't sleep anyway.
No kidding. No kidding. So, if someone wanted to get in touch with you, you know, for, you know, the prospect of you shooting a show for them or an event or whatever, what would be the best way to get in touch with you? And also, please give us your social media contact as well.
Oh, yeah. I thought you were going to ask for Social Security, and I was like, is this what happens on podcasts? I'm not too savvy.
Blood type. Yeah.
Yes. Just go ahead and slide that number to me. But, yeah, so if you need to contact a photographer, and bear in mind, I will shoot anything within reason that you're willing to pay for. If you are a promoter and you want your wrestlers to look their absolute best, call me. You can hit me up on Facebook at Fisticuffs Photography, or Instagram at Fisticuffs Photography, or Twitter at Fisticuffs Photo. Message me on any of those, and I will reply quickly. And then also, you could always email me at robert@fisticuffsphotography.com. That hits me on my phone wherever I'm at. So just let me know that you need me. We'll discuss, you know, how we can make some art together.
Awesome. And I'm sure that Mr. Bunkhouse Bob will get those links up on the show page, because that's what he does. We'll get those links up on our website as well if you want to contact Robert for his photographing extraordinary skills. And, you know, we
definitely
ask every guest. Definitely. You know, we ask every guest to record a bump for us, you know. Basically,
right.
you know the drill. So whenever you're ready, you can go.
All right. This is Rob with Fisticuffs Photography telling you to tune in to Live from the Armory with Bunkhouse Bob and the lovely Laura.
Woo-hoo!
How was that?
That was awesome.
That's one of the best bumps we've had.
They call me One Take Rob. No, they don't really, but.
I don't know. I'm still partial to Cliff Compton and his 900 takes.
Exactly. You got to be, yeah.
Just for the
Cliff
pure
just had
comedic
a session. Exactly. Well, Robert, we're going to let you go. Thank you so much for coming on and talking with us. I've had a blast, and we will do this again soon, I promise.
That's awesome. I really appreciate you guys bringing me on, and like I said, reach out whenever, and we'll do it again.
Thanks so much. Have a good night.
All right, you too. Bye.
Bye. And there goes Mr. Robert Holt from Fisticuffs Photography. Switch into that, George.
I really liked him, and he's very cool, very like-minded individual, which is awesome to see. And you know, it's the funny thing, we talked about it on the year special we did, is how wrestling can bring people together. I would have never seen his photography without wrestling, and I think he does amazing work. And you know, that's an artist that may not have been known if it wasn't for the great sport of wrestling.
Exactly. You know, it brings people together, and people that I would never have thought that, you know, what had anything in common with other than wrestling, but, you know, come to find out, both of you are punk fans, and he's a B-movie fan, which I knew he was seeing that shirt. You could have knocked me over the feather seeing that shirt on him, because I hadn't seen that movie in, like, 30 years. I'm going to talk about it because it gives me nightmares. Real quick, I want to go over, I want to go over some indie events. New Wave Pro presents Upsurge Friday, February 3rd at the, it's a Fight TV taping, Fight app. New Wave Pro Arena in Terre Haute, Indiana. You can find out more information by visiting the Facebook New Wave Pro page. Ring of Honor presents Undisputed Legacy Friday, February 3rd at the Austin Highway Event Center, San Antonio, Texas. And then the next day, Honor Reigns Supreme, Saturday, February 4th at Gilly's in Dallas, Texas. That'd be awesome to go see a show at Gilly's. You can find out more information by visiting Triple. Like,
correct
know,
me if
Gilly's.
I'm wrong, but isn't that the isn't that the Rhinestone Cowboy thing as well?
Well, I think you're thinking of Urban Cowboy.
Urban Cowboy, that's what I meant. Yeah.
Yeah, with John Travolta. Yeah, same place. Yep.
Okay. Just I knew it was named after the singer, but I remember it from the movie as well.
Yeah, I think
but
that's what kind of put it on the map. No, you're fine. ROHWrestling.com. AAW presents The End of Innocence Saturday, February 4th. At the Knights of Columbus in LaSalle, Indiana, look at me, in LaSalle, Illinois, you can find out more information by visiting www.aawrestling.com. Chikara presents National Pro Wrestling Day! Woo! Saturday, February 4th at the Wrestle Factory in George's hometown, Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. You can find out, what did you say?
I was just cheering. Gotta love when our boys do well.
You can find out more information by visiting www.chikarapro.com. And every time someone says Philadelphia, I don't want to start this. In West Philadelphia, born and raised.
Well, before you go on to that, in previous years, so I'm pretty sure they'll do it again. If you go to the Chikara Pro website, they stream, I believe, either all of National Pro Wrestling Day or more than half
of
it, because they put on enough where it's an entire show you can watch, and it's not just Chikara that shows up. It's a bunch of promotions that are showcased.
Awesome. Well, hey, listen to George. You go places. ChikaraPro.com. ECCW presents Kit's Choice, K-I-T-S. It's from Bob, not me, so if it's wrong, you blame the sick man. Fans pick the match stipulation Saturday, February 4th, the Russian Community Center in Vancouver, British Columbia. You can find out more information by visiting www.eccw.com. And we've come to the point in the show where we announce next week's guest. And I'm real excited about next week's guest because we wanted to get them on. We've had two of the members on already, but now we've got all of them. All of them. The Power will be guests next week. It's going to be epic, y'all. It is. I can't wait to have all of them on here. I mean, it's just going to be. And, you know, this is another group you don't need to sleep on, people.
Just to toot my horn, but I believe I was the one that initially suggested this back when the Playboy was on with us.
Yes. Yes. You did. You did. See, so.
About to toot my own horn.
I'll toot it for you.
I think it's going to be awesome if anyone heard the show with the ugly ducklings. I believe we're going to have a similar fun next week with that show. Those guys are all fun, all entertaining, all great guys, none of them have problem talking and promoting themselves.
No, you got the Monster, Montana Black. You've got Big Time Yaw. You've got Ian. You've got the Playboy, Bobby Ballantyne. So we're really looking forward to having them on next week. And please, you know, if you're new, thank you for, you know, listening to us. And please stay for next week. I think you're going to be pleasantly entertained, most certainly. And I would like to thank George for co-hosting with me on a little bit of a short notice because of Bob being under the weather, which I hope you're feeling better, Bob. I hope you are taking care of yourself. You should have been taking care of yourself all along. And, yes, I am. I'm waggling my finger at you. But thank you so much for stepping in and helping me. It's always a blast when we do this. And, of course, we went over. Me and you, we always go over. So.
Well, you're definitely welcome. And that seems to be our bane of our existence. We don't know how to color within the lines. But I blame Mr. Holt as well. He had us talking on some subjects. Nah, I'm just kidding. It was fun. I can't blame him for anything. It was an awesome time. And sometimes when you're having a good time, it lasts a little bit longer than you think it should or that you planned on.
Exactly. And I would rather, you know, let someone talk than to say, hey, you know, we've got this time schedule got to keep. So, you know,
if we didn't have the 3-hour limitation, I still think we'd be on that first conversation with Tommy.
We probably would. We'd still be talking to Tommy. Oh, Lord. Well, thank you.
He was going to talk till the millennium came.
He certainly was. And when, you know, I had to call him, he was like, what the hell happened? I'm like, well, you know, we talked too long. Log talk kicked us off. but, again, thank you so much for always being there when we need you so much. Thank you. And for being a great co-executive producer is what Bob always has these long titles. for fact-checking and everything, thank you so much. And I had a blast, as always, hosting with you. Is there anything you would like to leave our listeners with?
No, just it's been a blast, and I always enjoy stepping in, whether it be for you or be for Bob. I'd prefer you both be here because I love both of you guys. You guys are both great friends and great hosts, but I don't mind being the third fiddle to such great first and second fiddles.
Well, George, thank you. You make me blush. Well, we will see you next week, folks. And remember, there's never a bad seat here at the Armory. Talk to you next week.
You have been listening to Live from the Armory Wrestling Show, the premier podcast of indie wrestling. Listen to us on blogtalkradio.com every Wednesday night at 7 p.m. Eastern Time. Subscribe to us on iTunes. Follow us on Twitter at From the Armory. We're also streamed worldwide on www.fnx.network. And we're also available on Stitcher. You can find us on Facebook at facebook.com/live.armory.9. If you like what you hear, please take a few moments to give us a 5-star rating on iTunes. Thank you for listening. See you next week.
My dad is big on safety, so the Toyota Highlander with safety sense is perfect for him. It's also great for me because I daydream. It comes with pedestrian detection, which stops for Bigfoot should he step in front of us. If only it could do my homework.
Qualified lessees can lease a stylish new 2017 Highlander LE for only $299 a month for 36 months with $29.99 due at signing. Toyota, let's go places. Drivers should always be responsible for their own safe driving. Depending on the condition of the roads, vehicles, weather, etc., the systems may not work as intended. Visit gstoffers.com for details. Offers available in select states and in 5117.